It's been a while since we've last seen the Tsuji family. Not sure if some of my audience are familiar to this kind-hearted family, nor an interesting element that bears the Tsuji name. Who isn't too keen with the idea of family bonding? And of course, we may be questioning the horror from this pleasant scenery, but I assure you, my friends, much like every family, there's always a shameful secret hidden away behind a locked door. A terror that's probably best kept hidden within the shadows and away from prying eyes. But for this one family, for those of us who are familiar with the Tsujis, should be fully aware of their secret and how it's a terror within its own unique way. Oh yes, I know that we may be witnessing a scene of this hallmark family celebrating the birthday of a visiting member within this family, Machina's birthday. It seems like the Tsuji's shameful little secret isn't too fond of the family's way of celebrating somebody else's birthday. Not only because of how this devious child has a vindictive history with Machina, the only one who would be foolish enough to stand between him and his goals of spreading the joys of terror, but the fact that this boy would see Machina's birthday party as a personal attack. Soichi, my friends. The shameful secret who tends to stalk this kind-hearted family from the shadows, like an unwelcome pest who likes to remain hidden within the walls, the ceiling, and even beneath the floorboards, just to keep an eye on each member of the family. Except his pranks, or his idea of enjoyment, tends to have a special ingredient of evil, making Soichi dance between the lines of either a problem child or an unpredictable monster. But for the Tsuji family, regardless of the child's obsession with the supernatural and macabre, they still see the boy as nothing more but a problem child than a force of evil to be reckoned with, more like an annoying pest than an element of unremitting horror. Which is why the family ignored Suichi's horrid way of wishing Machina's happy birthday by spitting a nail into the cake, vowing that the only time he would celebrate such a day was when it's the anniversary of her death. Which is kinda overdue, by the way. But for this family moment, Machina's birthday celebration was something that had given Soichi more than a strong sense of inner disgust. It was that vindictive spite brewing within Soichi, escalating into something on a personal level, seeing how it was also Soichi's birthday as well. Of course, with her previous issues with the problem child, you could say that Machina isn't too thrilled by this unexpected discovery. But for Soichi, you could say that the idea of sharing the same birthday would influence hatred with creativity. And knowing Soichi, not only are the Tsuji family fully aware of his habit of ruining such moments with his annoying behavior and mischievous pranks, but the fact that every time someone upsets him, strange things tend to happen, like an unseen force preying upon those who get on his bad side. Like Koichi mysteriously tripping onto Machina's cake when the family decided to celebrate the birthday in the other room. Such a glorious scene for Soichi when seeing his brother's face planted into Machina's cake. Except for a child who fancies himself within the forces of evil, things usually don't work out as he expected, which explains why his older brother was able to save himself from accidentally destroying Machina's cake and saving the birthday party. So after the Tsuji family enjoyed the cake while discussing the incident where Koichi had nearly fallen face first into the cake, Koichi could have sworn that he was tripped by someone. Somebody who was hiding within one of the rooms. But when he and the other members of the family checked the room, nobody was there. As I said, when getting on Soichi's bad side, strange things tend to happen. However, aside from Koichi being tripped by a mysterious ghost, there was something else that Machina had been dwelling upon for quite some time. Why is it that Soichi is so different from his family? It's like he resembles nobody within the Tsuji family. Well, even though the Tsuji family can confirm that Soichi isn't an adopted child as many have assumed, that curiosity would be best described with Grandma Sachi, and we're looking upon the only picture that the Tsuji family have of Granny Sachi, alongside with Suichi when he was a baby boy, you can immediately see the resemblance. And as for Granny's strange posture within the picture, well, that is a long story. You see, before Suichi's birth, Granny Sachi was the shameful secret of the Tsuji family, known as the fortune-telling hag, who had a reputation of terrifying people with her strange and vile behavior, even though only a few of her fortunes would come to pass. Grandma Sachi was strongly persistent on being recognized as a fortune-teller whose power should be taken more seriously, somebody who should be feared, rather than being made a mockery of. It was when Misako became pregnant with Suichi, her third child, that was when Granny Sachi began tormenting the poor woman with her vile fortunes, beginning with the claim that Misako will have a miscarriage. So confident that Sachi claimed that Misako would lose the child on the fourth month, after falling down a flight of stairs. And even though Misako had found it difficult ignoring Grandma Sachi's horrid fortunes, giving her a sense of dread when fearing that the fortune may come to pass, especially when going up and down the stairs. Thankfully, after the fourth month had came to pass and entering the seventh month, there was no accident. Of course, this had no effect with Granny Sachi's confidence as a fortune teller, in her determination to foresee the events of Misako giving birth, which is why she arrogantly dismissed her previous claims as a common mistake, and began saying that Misako will not only be giving birth, which will be on June 6 at 6 a.m. by the way, she will be giving birth to a set of twins, and she'll also be giving birth to a baby demon, an adorable baby demon. That was something Granny Sachi was confident on getting right. On May 2nd, when Misako began experiencing contractions, ready for delivery, that was when Granny Sachi took back her fortune, again, by claiming that she had accidentally added an extra month. The twins were to be born on May 5th at 5 in the morning. It was on May 3rd, 6 in the morning, that was when Misako had given birth to Suichi, who wasn't so adorable. So you would have thought that the old hag would have been smart and seized this whole fortune-telling facade to bring an end on embarrassing herself with the rambling nonsense. Unfortunately, things had only gotten worse with Grandma Sachi. Even though the Tsuji family believed that Granny Sachi's fortunes were nothing but a bunch of superstitious nonsense, sharing this with the old hag was not a wise decision. Even when Granny Sachi's denial had reached a new level when she strongly believed that Misako did in fact give birth to twins. Not just one child, as everybody believed. Suichi and Soji, which she named herself. Even when Granny would go so far to where she even demanded two cribs, extra toys, and food, acting out as if she were literally comforting and playing with an invisible child alongside with Suichi. Of course, the Tsuji family had not only found this ridiculous, but incredibly unsettling. Even when she would give the imaginary Soji one of Sayuri's or Koichi's toys, because of her vile behavior, especially when getting on her bad side, the family knew that confronting Granny Sachi wasn't the popular decision, which is why they prefer to leave her be with her disturbing charade. But just when Misako reluctantly began tolerating Granny Sachi's disturbing behavior, it was when she began noticing how Suichi would have more of a resemblance to Granny in regards to appearance and personality. Misako didn't like the fact that Suichi would have more of a connection with Granny than his biological mother. It was because of how Granny would spoil Suichi, going against Misako's opinions by embracing Suichi's deviant behavior, causing the child to grow up as an unbearable brat. Basically, what Granny was doing wasn't right. And yet, Misako, nor any member of the family, didn't know how to confront her. And as Suichi got older, his personality and behavior became more like Granny, such as the bad habit of biting down on toothpicks, an oral fixation that would later graduate into nails. and even sharing Granny's charade of pretending like he was playing with a twin brother. The fact was, Granny and Soichi were very close, and it was always like that. Up until Soichi's fourth birthday, when Granny Sachi mysteriously disappeared, saying that she was going to take Soji for a walk. That was the last time anybody had ever seen her. Even after the Tsuji family tried looking for her, Granny Sachi was nowhere to be found. It was like she suddenly vanished. No trace or anything. Except someone claiming that they seen an old lady who not only fit the description, but was found alongside with the child, who was about Soichi's age and resemblance. Which of course was something that the Tsuji family easily dismissed, assuming that it was just a mistake. After the birthday party and the curious backstory as to why and how Soichi became the obnoxious brat that we know of today, unfortunately, Machina's day of celebration wasn't as pleasant as she hoped for. Of course, the party was fine and all, but it was right after the party that's when her day began to sour, and it shouldn't be a mystery as to who would be responsible. It's kind of sad how a peaceful, kind-hearted family would be forced to endure something like Soichi or even Sachi. According to the Tsuji family, nobody knew why Granny Sachi was a bitter and downright malicious woman. Unlike most people who have a reason for such behavior, it was a natural thing for Granny Sachi. For Machina, in her previous experience with the boy, she just couldn't avoid the inner feeling that even without Sachi's influence, Soichi would still be the same demonic obsessed child who takes pride with its dangerous pranks and mischievous behavior. And even though Machina understood why the Tsuji family felt helpless against Soichi and his unwanting behavior, that a peaceful family lacking the proper experience against a child like Soichi, that maybe Soichi was a child that severely lacked discipline, that maybe the kind-hearted family just didn't have what it took to handle a problem child. Of course, all that and more may be true, but for Machina, along with their horrible experience with Soichi, she definitely knew why the Tsuji family were helpless against Soichi. It was because they feared him. You see, what happened, it was right after the party when Machina went to fetch a blanket from the cupboard. She not only found Soichi hiding within the cupboard, but Granny Sachi as well. The old woman scolding her for not having the decency to knock before opening the door, for having no respect, a poor upbringing, that maybe Granny needs to teach this girl a good lesson. And seeing Sachi had not only terrified Machina, but had her convinced that it was nothing more but a hallucination because of how Koichi and the family couldn't find any trace of Granny Sachi. This is how Soichi does it. His power over his family, by having people fear him because of his pranks, his obsession with the supernatural. And right now, Machina is experiencing that fear, especially when Soichi promising another birthday party later that night, his birthday party. And tonight, Granny Sachi and his twin brother are not only going to be visiting Soichi on his birthday, but Granny's going to teach Machina a thing or two about some respect. Such exciting news that Soichi had to share with Machina, that Granny's not happy with her. In fact, she even hates her, which is why tonight, she's going to pay her a visit and do some terrible things to her. The fear of Soichi's mischievous terror was just enough to deprive Machina from a peaceful night asleep, hoping that the dreadful night would come to pass and be nothing more but Machina dwelling upon one of Soichi's unfulfilled promises for revenge, which is quite common. Unfortunately, the silent night being disturbed by Soichi's hideous laughter downstairs, that was when Machina knew something was going to happen. And when Machina quietly went into her brother's room, who was unresponsive to her reluctant attempts of waking him. Absolute terror had struck Machina when Soichi's laughter would be joined by another, overhearing the familiar voice of a vile woman who scolded her earlier that day, demanding to know where Machina's room was at, so that she can take Soji and together teach the ungrateful wench a lesson. Granny's going to make her think twice before deciding to ruin Soichi's birthday. That's right, my friends. Granny is coming. And it wasn't a hallucination nor a nightmare, a genuine horror that would have the poor girl hiding within her brother's room, watching the old woman and child walk by and entering the next room. It was when Machina desperately tried waking her brother, that was when Machina would be grabbed by Soji. And even though the poor girl kicked and screamed, hoping that either her brother or somebody within the house would be awakened by the commotion, it seemed like Machina's frantic attempts of disrupting the peaceful night was having no success. As Granny stated, nobody can hear her. Nobody is going to wake up. No matter how loud she screams, nobody is going to save her. Because right now, Granny is going to teach her a good lesson. Granny's going to cut off her head, let it dry out, maybe brew it with some whiskey, and there's nothing Machina can do about it. Of course, there was someone within the house who was hearing Machina's desperate screams for help, and obviously Suichi was enjoying every second of it. To think that Machina would have a birthday party without inviting him. The girl who knows how to ruin everything, who would dare make a mockery of Suichi and his great power. Now, Suichi can enjoy the night within his room, enjoy his birthday with the music of Machina's screaming throughout the night. Granny always knows how to spoil her beloved Suichi, especially on his birthday. Not sure what Granny will do to Machina. Not like Suichi cares, seeing how his cousin deserves whatever becomes of the night. But when entering his room, Suichi did not expect that his night would end with a surprise gift. On the desk was a piece of Machina's cake, with a nail stuck in it, and a letter saying, "Happy birthday from Machina." And as Machina desperately cried and begged for her brother to wake up while being strangled by both Soji and Granny, enough terror to bring the girl to tears. Just like that, both Granny Sachi and Soji had disappeared, leaving the shaken girl literally petrified and trying to figure out what just happened. And as Machina began recovering from her traumatic experience, downstairs, away from prying eyes, you could hear the sounds of an infamous problem child enjoying a piece of cake. Hard work, my friends, always pays off in the end. Unless you're within the walls of the Tsuji household. With hard work, you might find yourself with an unexpected surprise. Today's horror story, my friends, is a very unique one. A tale of a familiar mischief maker that likes to toy with the forces of darkness. And as always, things tend to go horribly wrong when a plan isn't properly thought out, but still makes quite of an interesting story to share. Koichi has finals coming up. Unfortunately, studying hasn't been that easy for the young man. In fact, because of Koichi's younger brother, concentrating on his schoolwork has literally become impossible. The sounds of his little brother Suichi running around and jumping in the attic was crippling Koichi's ability to stay focused. Usually, Suichi is quiet when he's in the attic or in his room, doing Lord knows what. But of all days, a time where Koichi needed peace and quiet the most, Suichi has to go and ruin it. And when Koichi had enough of the ruckus, storming into the living room where his family and Suichi was at, explaining his situation on how Suichi was interrupting his studies with all the noise he was making in the attic, demanding for his troublemaking brother to stop these antics. However, Koichi's family was a bit confused. It couldn't have been Suichi who was in the attic. He's been in the living room the entire time. Even though Suichi is normally a pest with his pranks and strange behavior, it's not healthy to blame the boy every time something happens. And even though Koichi is a bit confused, looking upon the smirk on Suichi's face, biting into the nails that were in his mouth, Koichi was for certain that this was Suichi's doing. Later that evening, when the noises in the attic have finally stopped, Koichi still found his studying being interrupted,
Only this time, it was his brother's faint voice. Outside Koichi's room, it sounded like the brat was trying to put some kind of spell on Koichi. Fell. Get 0 grades. Get scolded by the teacher. Fell, Koichi. Fell. Repeated over and over. Even though Koichi tried everything he could to ignore his brother, knowing that giving him attention would only worsen the situation, there was so much Koichi could take before storming out of his room once again and chasing the brat down the hallway. Definitely, Suichi was the one making all the noises in the attic. And now this. Fed up with Suichi trying to hinder his studies, Koichi tackled his brother, demanding for the brat to bring an end to his mischievous campaign. However, when pinning Suichi to the ground, who not only pleaded his innocence, claiming that he wasn't at Koichi's door, that he was running to the restroom because he had to go pee, while demanding to be let go, that was when Suichi emptied his bladder on the floor. Twice now, Koichi's parents felt that Koichi was being unfair against his younger brother, blaming the child for the noises in the attic that he didn't make, and now preventing Suichi from going to the restroom? Regardless of how it looks, Koichi was for certain that his brother was purposely interrupting his studies. This is what he does. The child is a prankster, a manipulator. He thrives on things like this. And yet, his father still plays it off as no big deal, so easily buying into Suichi playing an innocent role within all this, a victim to his brother's bullying. Suichi, claiming that everybody knows that the noises didn't come from him. Maybe his brother is a bit crazy. Or maybe it was a ghost. Yeah, a mischievous ghost. That's what was making the noises in the attic, and saying those horrible and honest things outside Koichi's room. Come to think of it, it makes perfect sense. With sounds of knocking at night, the cold temperature within the house, could it be that the Tsuji household is haunted? Ghosts. Koichi seriously doubts that it's ghosts that's interrupting his studies. Only a moron will buy into something like that. So, Koichi is underestimating the supernatural. Something that Suichi found to be hilarious, that his older brother would think of him as a moron, when knowing that terrible things come to those who would dare deny the supernatural. Meaning that something very bad is going to happen to Koichi, and his little brother is going to enjoy every minute of it. Hopefully, Koichi's outburst may have worked. Seriously doubt it. With talk of ghosts in the Tsuji household being haunted, such nonsense. It's highly doubtful that the brat was far from ending his pestering campaign against Koichi. But once again, with Koichi's concentration being broken because of the knocking in the ceiling again, definitely his brother's doing. Aside from the noises in the attic, things are about to get interesting when Koichi noticed the shaking on the dresser, the alarm clock, book, the pencil holder moving and shaking around, before the objects begin to float and then drop. And behind Koichi was his tea kettle, floating in the air and shaking around violently, spilling the liquid contents everywhere before dropping onto the floor. And yet, Koichi wasn't still buying into it. Maybe it was because of how Koichi felt that the supernatural occurrence within his room didn't feel supernatural. Maybe it's because things like this are common within the Tsuji household. Why Koichi was more bothered by the disturbance instead of fearing that his room was actually being haunted by a ghost. And when noticing the small thread tied to the kettle, and taking a good look at his room, Koichi noticing the lines of thread on the ceiling and walls, tied to the moving objects, leading to the cupboard, and as expected, Suichi hiding within Koichi's room. going through great lengths to convince his older brother that he was being haunted by a ghost, trying everything he can to disrupt his brother's peace and quiet. And now, here's Suichi caught red-handed, with a thread in his hands and the stomping on the ceiling. Sure, Suichi may have been the one pulling the strings. He'll admit to that. But that wasn't him jumping around in the attic. That was the ghost. Suichi was just lending a helping hand. The noises, the pranks. It's obvious that Suichi is hell-bent on making sure that Koichi fails his finals. And yet, none of that was worse than realizing how his father was more avoidant on fixing this problem. A father who had lost his will to properly discipline his troubled son. Describing Suichi as a leopard that can't change his spots, this was always his excuse. And when Koichi had given his father an ultimatum, that if he doesn't do something about Suichi, then Koichi has no other choice but to rent some apartment and do his revisions there. And that was when Mr. Tsuji came up with an idea that will help Koichi with his studies, and avoid having to deal with Suichi. A friend of his, who owns a carpeting business, well, it may cost a lot, but Mr. Tsuji can hire his friend to soundproof Koichi's room. Obviously not the best idea, but it's much better than having to deal with Suichi's relentless assault against Koichi's time for studying. But for one mischievous devil, overhearing this conversation, had a much better idea to torment his brother than relying on threads, noises, and a ghost. Unfortunately, Mr. Tsuji wasn't able to make an appointment with Abata's construction company until a month later, which would be too late for Koichi's finals. But all hope wasn't lost, my friends, seeing how the following morning, the Tsuji family had a stroke of luck when a carpenter from Abata's construction company showed up to their household. A Mr. Tagaisu, who's not only here to help a good friend of his boss, but is more than willing to make sure that Koichi's room is absolutely sound-free, free of charge. For Mr. Tagaisu knows how important it is for somebody to be fully prepared for them exams. Even though Mr. and Mrs. Tsuji found Tagaisu very generous and friendly, a bit weird, but someone who is truly devoted with his work. His goals of soundproofing Koichi's room with the latest installation technology. Koichi, however, strongly felt that there was something very off with the carpenter when he first met the guy, especially when Tagaisu explained how he was installing 4 layers of soundproofing walls. Koichi was kind of skeptic. 4 layers of soundproof sounded a bit too much. But Tagaisu strongly believed that it was perfect. Of course, 2 or 3 layers wouldn't do. If he could, he would go for 9. But 4, which sounds like the word for death, 4 is perfect for cutting off the silence. Aside from the weird sense of enthusiasm within Mr. Tagaisu, Koichi was also a bit bothered with the fact that the strange carpenter had taken a liking to Suichi when watching the boy hammering nails into the wall, while laughing and chanting, "Die, die, die." Tagaisu felt that the boy had a talent, could become something special with the way he was hammering those nails, which is why Tagaisu was more than happy to have Suichi assist him. That night, after Mr. Tagaisu was done for the day, the Tsuji family was very impressed how far Tagaisu had gotten with Koichi's room. Says that by tomorrow, Koichi's room should be finished. But also, the Tsujis were very shocked when hearing Tagaisu praising Suichi for his assistance before leaving. Because of how the boy had been helping him all day, that's why Tagaisu was able to get a lot done within a single day. Says that the way Suichi hammers the nails, it's quite a wonder to behold. A skill that will definitely get the boy far in life. The kind words that had Mr. Tsuji believing that maybe, just maybe, that this will have Suichi change into a good boy. Of course, for Koichi, who's very familiar with Suichi and his deceitful tactics, he just couldn't help but have that horrible suspicion that there was something not right about all this, especially when his father decided to check in on his son's room out of curiosity and find that the door to Koichi's room was locked. Indeed, my friends, something was happening within the Tsuji household. In the following day, after Koichi came home from school, that inner suspicion he had, something horrible was going to happen, was about to become a reality when noticing that the window to his room was nailed shut. According to Mr. Tagaisu, the reason why he removed the window was because of how sound penetrates the windows, which would be a problem for Koichi's studying. And we can't have that now, can't we? And as of now, Koichi's room being completely soundproof, Mr. Tagaisu's work here was done. And watching the strange man happily leave with a sinister chuckle over his success, that was the last the Tsuji family had saw of Mr. Tagaisu. All that work finished within 2 days, free of charge. And the only person within the family who knows what became of his room is the sole reason why Koichi's room is being soundproofed. Immediately, Koichi rushed to his room, fearing of what horrors await behind the door to his new room. And when opening that door, was another door. And behind that door, was another door, which was smaller. 4 layers of wall, meaning that there was 4 doors to his room. And reluctantly opening the 4th door, you can say that Koichi was very surprised when seeing his new, fully soundproofed room. Even though Koichi could barely fit into his new room, seeing how the desk took up most of the space, you could say that Koichi's room definitely succeeds its goals of being soundproof. So with 4 layers of wall, the space within Koichi's room dramatically decreased. Obviously not what Koichi expected, but with the exams coming up, it's gonna have to do. That night, Mr. Tsuji found himself a bit concerned when calling his good friend Mr. Abata to thank him for soundproofing his son's room free of charge, and also praising Mr. Tagaisu for his hard work, generous behavior, and being a positive influence for his son, Suichi. But to Mr. Tsuji's surprise, Mr. Abata didn't know anything about the job, nor a man named Tagaisu who works for him. Aside from that bit of mystery, Koichi had found himself growing fond to his new room, admiring its architect. Regardless of the fact that there was no space to stand nor move in, the silence gave Koichi enough concentration to study. Oh yes, the room was definitely sound-free, as if Koichi had gone deaf. Though Koichi wasn't sure if staying in the room for a certain amount of time would be a good thing. It's said that too much silence can have a devastating toll on one's mental health. But then again, Koichi had never been able to study like this in months. Nothing but peace and quiet, completely free from any disruptive sounds. Until Koichi's concentration would be interrupted by the sounds of a cricket, chirping sounds, with unpredictable intervals, piercing into Koichi's mind, depriving the young man from his ability to stay focused, robbing him from his sanity, Koichi's mind being forced into that unwelcoming noise entering his small room. Leaving the room, Koichi learned that the chirping sound was only coming from his soundproof room, which was nothing but a faint noise when standing outside the 4 doors. It was impossible. How the hell is the noise coming from his room? It was supposed to be soundproof. Unless, according to the spaces between the doors entering his room, of course. Soichi. 4 layers of wall. enough space to accommodate a person, which means that Suichi is in between the gaps, making that horrible noise. Knowing how Suichi likes to lurk around within the attic, Koichi wasn't surprised to find an opening to his new room through the ceiling. As expected, there was space between the walls, just enough for a person to move around in. Noticing the lights, the ladders, and the small doors, the space between the four walls were furnished, purposely made for a small person. It's obvious that Tegaisu deliberately made this for Suichi. Not knowing how Suichi managed to get somebody into building something like this. But either way, Suichi's pranks had gone too far. Which is why Koichi was fully determined to bring an end to this pestering madness. And managing to crawl through the tight space between the third and fourth walls, and then through the small door that brought Koichi into the space between the third and second walls, and another door hidden underneath, which brought him to the space between the first and second walls, following the chirping noises as they grew more louder, overhearing the sinister glee of Suichi's plans on driving his stupid brother into madness. And there he was, on the ladder, Suichi, lurking behind the very wall where Koichi was studying, immediately scolding his brother for what had become of his room. Koichi, completely fed up with Suichi's endless tactics of driving him mad and his attempts of sabotaging his finals. And even though Suichi began to flee from the wrath of his brother, possibly avoiding another moment of being disciplined, or maybe this was Suichi showing his brother the other wonders of this beautiful design when going to the other side of the room. And when following Suichi in the space between the third and second walls, oblivious to the fact that the brat wasn't just fleeing from him, but guiding Koichi down a darkened space between the walls, Koichi not knowing that these walls were covered with nails. And after watching Koichi lose his grip when climbing down this wall, suffering from a nasty fall, a little feature that Suichi proudly called his pinball zone, Koichi, whose clothes were torn, body riddled with scrapes and cuts, and so infuriated that he was completely oblivious to the fact that his brother was leading him through a series of traps, fully determined to give his brother something that he should have gotten a long time ago, a good lashing. All Koichi has to do is just make his way through this damn contraption. And when the little brat crawled through the door, entering the space between the second and first wall, Koichi was nearly close on getting his hands on Suichi, just moments away from doing what his mother and father should have done years ago, by making Suichi pay for his pranks, his mischievous behavior, everything he has done to torment his family. And when trying to reach the roof of the second wall, that was when Koichi had once again lost his grip and fell into a pool of filthy water. No, not water. The sewage tank. Another interesting feature that Suichi wanted his brother to see. Well, Koichi finally knew when to quit. Lord knows what else Suichi had in store for him within those walls. Which is why the young man did the right thing by climbing out of his room and moved to another room for his studying. Even though Suichi did have his moment of vengeful fun by tormenting Koichi, Suichi did not succeed with his goals of seeing his older brother fail his exams, meaning that Koichi still got enough study time to pass his finals. And yes, Suichi did get the better of his brother until he ended up falling victim to his own trap that night when he got stuck in between the walls within Koichi's room, almost died from asphyxiation before he was rescued. It took a couple months, a lot of money, but thanks to Mr. Obata, Koichi's room was fully restored back to normal. As for the man known as Mr. Tegaisu, well, to this very day, his whereabouts, who he was, or where he came from, still remains a mystery. Something I've noticed from my audience is how many of you are cat lovers? Of course, I have some who are dog lovers, a few bird owners, one who loves his reptiles. I'm a rabbit person myself, but it's interesting how so many viewers are cat lovers. Today's unremitting horror. It feels so good breaking the rules. Our story will be told through the joys and misadventures of an adorable stray cat. After finding kindness from a stranger, our curious cat following this young lady home will not only result with the cat finding a new home and adopted into a kind-hearted and loving family, but will give us a story of its encounter with a vile and malicious evil. Yes, all families have a secret or two kept hidden away from the world, but this one likes to run wild, spreading mischief and corruption, wishing cruelty and suffering upon others. An evil that has a deep hatred for people, and most of all, his own family. And now that there's an addition to this family who's given the name Colin, it's just a matter of time before this evil has its eye on this adorable cat. Cat lovers, animal lovers, I must warn you, there's an evil within this story that does not care about your feelings. What you are about to witness is an evil that will perform unspeakable acts upon this cat. Other than that, I hope you enjoy the show. At first glance, one would describe the Tsuji family as the perfect household. More like the idol example of a picture-perfect family. But for some of us who are familiar with the Tsujis, no, this family is anything but perfect, and are very aware that something sinister is bound to happen. Days after Colin was brought into the Tsuji family, loved and cared for, it was just a matter of time before Colin wanted to explore the rest of the household, our curious cat wanting to know more about its new family and home, but when noticing a door at the end of the hallway slightly open, Colin felt that there was something within the darkness behind the door, a curiosity that had Colin wanting to entertain this animalistic feeling. Oh yes, there was an evil inside that room, watching this foolish cat coming its way. And just as Colin had gotten close enough, that's when this evil made its introduction. The hand that stopped Colin in its tracks, belonging to a sadistic monster that came out to finally introduce himself to the new member of the family. Pretty little kitty. Since his sister Sayuri decided to infest Tsuji's house with this creature, they say that cats are the ones who are the true owners of the household. Pretty little Colin. Since Tsuji had been watching this cat through the walls, he knew that it was just a matter of time before this overgrown pest would take over the family and then the household. And when Colin refused to be touched by Tsuji, Colin having the inner feeling knowing that these hands brought no love, no kindness, nothing but anger, torture, and pain, the cat wanted nothing to do with this boy. And with the sounds of several nails being shot at the wall near Colin, it was a sign that this cat was in grave danger, and immediately Colin ran off. But thinking that the worst was already over, Tsuji was far from having fun with this cat, a new member of the family that needs to be taught a lesson in manners, and know who is the ruler of this house and stupid family, and throwing a noose around Colin, yanking the animal by the neck as it tried crawling and pulling itself away from the demonic child. Too bad this stupid family never taught Colin what happens when you disrespect Tsuji. A lesson that Tsuji is going to enjoy teaching himself. But when Tsuji heard his sister screaming his name, Sayuri furious over the horrible act she just witnessed, resulting with Tsuji being punched in the face and falling on the cat, causing the terrified Colin to slash Tsuji across the face before running away. They say animal cruelty are signs of a child who will grow up as an adult that will inflict the same pain and suffering upon humans. And for years, Koichi had been trying to explain this to his mother. How Suichi's behavior and several incidents in the past are indicators that his brother will grow up shaming the family name. And now here he is, abusing an animal. And yet Miss Tsuji still refuses to take these warning signs seriously. That's the problem with Tsuichi, how his mother and father don't do anything with his behavior. And even though they tried with that tutor a while back, which didn't work out, instead they rather baby him while he runs around terrorizing his family and other people. But the thing about Tsuichi is how vindictive he is when things don't go his way. How much spite he has for his own family, especially for his siblings. And now that there's a new member of the family, maybe a little curse is needed. A little corruption to set things straight. That's right. For a problem child that knows a thing or two with the dark arts, it takes time before they start seeing a few changes within Colin, like a sudden shock when touching the cat. Indicators that Tsuichi's curse has already taken effect. It's not like Colin is infected with an evil, but more like a curse that brings out the inner evil within Colin. Think of it as electroshock therapy, a little nudge to put Colin on the right path. Now with the cat slowly giving in to its inner instincts, just enough predatory behavior to have Tsuichi entertain himself by playing with Colin with a dead snake tied to a stick. The idea is not only to bring out the best in Colin, but to make him Suichi's beloved pet. They said that Tsuichi hates animals, that he hates people, but after making some adjustments, Tsuichi is going to prove his siblings wrong, that he can love animals and people. And watching the cat grab the snake and taking it to the corner of the hallway to feast upon its decomposing body. A scene that had not only brought a sinister smile upon Suichi's face, but left Sayori and Koichi helpless, knowing that Colin was giving in to its animalistic instincts, and there was nothing they can do about it. Some people argue that cats are considered as the most popular pets in the world. I'm not sure about the accuracy on that, but I do know that there are enough cat owners who have had terrible experiences with their cats. 2 weeks ago, the Tsujis brought home this adorable little cat, but then they started noticing some changes. Colin's behavior was more erratic, territorial, and predatory. Not as warming as he was when Sayori brought him home. Almost every time Colin would go outside, he would bring back something to feast on. A bird, rat, roach, a spider, a giant centipede, and just watching Colin crunching into its prey was enough to bring shock and disgust within Sayori. And then there was the walls and the furnishings that would be scratched and ruined, and Colin urinating and defecating everywhere within the house, other than his litter box. And even though Sayori and Koichi passed us off as Colin's way of marking his territory, there was just something about this that was abnormal, something that was more than typical cat behavior. It felt like Colin was acting this way out of maliciousness. But Sayori and Koichi never thought that Colin's behavior would be connected to Tsuichi. Until one day, when Colin came home with a new creature to feast on. Not knowing what it was. It looked like a mutated spider with several eyes or antennas. It had a terrible stench to it, like it had died for days, or was found in the sewage. And watching Colin feast upon the slimy flesh of this creature was a sight that had almost made both Sayori and Koichi throw up. Tsuichi, however, oh how he started loving Colin, especially the thing he brought back from hell. Maybe next time Colin decides to visit hell again, he might bring back something alive. Funny how Koichi thinks that Colin found some foreign insect or something like that. And after the incident of making a few changes to his brother's room, a visit from Grandma, and the incident with Grandfather, Koichi still refusing to accept Suichi's magnificent power of the dark arts. And Suichi's sister, why would she want to name his cat Colin when it's Colin? But that's okay, because Suichi has grown to love Colin. And when watching Siri grab her cat and run off, escaping the inevitable, because it's just a matter of time before Colin fully succumbs to the curse. How we humans have entertained the thoughts of wishing curses upon others. And then we define ourselves as someone who would never wish ill upon others, but enjoy the true horror of these inner thoughts when facing our own reflection, realizing how these thoughts make us no different than this demonic child. But too cowardly to admit it. Instead, we demonize others who would dare think of such things, just so we can make our image of positivity more convincing. If you think about it, you might see why Suichi despises people so much, and yet has this inner strive to be accepted by society, but only by his own terms, a society that isn't afraid to show how they are equally sinister and dark. As for the situation with Colin, as a result of Colin's predatory behavior bringing more creatures into the house, Koichi was forced to board up all the windows in the house just so Colin wouldn't escape and bring back something else to sink his teeth into. But these efforts of controlling Colin's strange behavior had only worsened the situation. Now with the windows boarded up, the air was not only dense, filthy, it had a strong odor to it. It reeked of cat feces and urine. And upon further examination, the Tsujis began noticing something small in the air, small strands of cat hair dancing. And when noticing how Colin had been seen for quite some time, Koichi and Sayori couldn't find the cat when searching the entire house, except Suichi's room, which was where Colin was at. Well, I think we can safely say Colin, who was found right in the arms of his new owner. Soichi's curse had reached its final stage. Colin was now beyond recognition, a creature with sinister eyes lined with thick crust, the hideous mouth decorated with jagged teeth, thick saliva and thin lines of blood dripping from Colin's sadistic smile, possibly from a recent kill. Colin was now a pet that only Suichi can love, and if Suichi can love animals, maybe he can do the same for people too. All it takes is a few adjustments, like some supernatural electrical shock therapy. And when seeing Colin scratching itself, causing Sayori and Koichi to be engulfed by a cloud of irritant cat hairs that filled Suichi's room, tickling the nostrils, the eyes stinging from sensitivity, causing fits of sneezing, explains why Suichi is wearing a protective face mask. Oh, how Suichi loves his beloved pet. To think that Sayori is still clinging on the foolish idea that Colin has any love for her, finding her hopeless attempt at reaching out to Suichi's cat amusing, especially when seeing Colin hissing in defense when Sayori tried grabbing him. For Suichi, watching his foolish sister running off in tears, heartbroken, had made him smile. Serves her right for striking Suichi across the face. And everything was going according to plan, until Koichi tried grabbing the cat himself. You see, humans tend to have static electricity built within their bodies, and well, with Colin being infected by a curse that causes his behavior and body to be changed by continuous shocks of electricity, imagine what will happen when the electricity within a person disrupts something like that. Thus giving Koichi that shocking experience, just enough to knock him off of his feet. Soichi, however, there was a reason why there's fear within this boy, thanks to his brother damaging the curse. Electricity within Colin was now building up, meaning that any minute now, the curse will cause Colin to be overloaded with so much electricity. Any second, all that power will be released. And even though Suichi tried tossing the cat away from him, still experiencing the waves of electricity surging through his body, the nails in Suichi's mouth bringing intense pain. Unfortunately, as a result of the curse, Colin belongs to Suichi, thus making Suichi and Colin inseparable. And out of an act of fear and desperation, Suichi tried running to Koichi with the hopes that his brother would help him to free him from this possessed cat. But instead of helping Suichi, which would be a hopeless effort, Koichi and the other members of the Tsuji family immediately ran from the house, trying to run as far away from Suichi as they can, because whatever happened to Colin, whatever curse Suichi brought upon that cat, Colin has so much power built within his body that all it takes is a single bite. And the moment when Colin sank its teeth into Suichi's flesh, It was just a few seconds of silence before this quiet, slumbering town would be shaken by a massive explosion of electricity. So this is Cullen's story. The adorable cat that got corrupted by an evil that lurks within the shadow of a kind-hearted family. After the explosion, I guess the curse was finally lifted when Cullen went back to his normal self. As for Suichi, however, he ended up being hospitalized for a few weeks. Of course, he'll be fine, up and running, causing mayhem and mischief for others, toying with the dark arts. Underestimate the supernatural forces of good and evil. You see, my friends, a lesson can be learned here. Evil is a choice, an essence within us all. And even though you may be the one who isn't afraid to show your true colors, using magic or forcing others into showing their inner evil is not only reckless, but also dangerous as well.